3, 2, 1, go! Level up.
Welcome to Real Talk TV. My name is Roger Henry and I'm your host for this week's Christmas special. And I've got two amazing guests who have come to visit us, Caddy and Stuart. Welcome.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about who you are.
Okay, well, we are the parents of the seven Caddy Masons, who are classical musicians and who play classical music, I suppose, around the world. Our third child is Sheku Caddy Mason, who played cello at the Royal Wedding. Wow, and we live in Nottingham, we're from Nottingham.
Yes.
That's brilliant. And yourself, Stuart, I mean, seven children. I've got to talk about it. Did you not have a TV?
We did have a TV, but perhaps we just couldn't find it.
You couldn't find the remote control.
We couldn't find the remote control, yes.
But such an amazing story. I mean, because the ages, they stagger. It's not, I mean, how old is your eldest?
Our eldest is 24 and our youngest is 11. And they were very close in age, the first five, certainly, and then they get a little bit further apart.
Right, okay. And was there any sort of defining moments as to why that happened, that you left a gap? Or was it like,
why we had seven? We always wanted four, actually. And then the fifth one came along, and then we talked again and thought, let's have another. And seven seemed like a beautiful number.
That's unbelievable. I mean, Caddy, I mean, I've got to say this, beautiful lady, lovely figure. What's the secret?
I think I've been so busy over the years, running around after them. Keeps you very fit.
Just a little bit, and I believe you're an academic as well, so how did you, a professor?
No, lecturer. I was a lecturer, but then I stopped after the second child because it just got busier and busier. And I kept meaning to go back to work, but then we kept having more children, so it never happened.
We kept having more children. Sounds great. And Stuart, what is it you do for a living?
So I work for a luxury hotel company, actually, in London. So,
So you were travelling to London as well as coming back?
Yeah, I've been travelling to London for work probably now 13 years, actually. 14 years I've been going back and forth from Nottingham. Yeah.
And who's the organiser between you two? I mean, seven children, I'm assuming it's you, Caddy.
Well, with Stuart being away all week, either in London or abroad, it was kind of me on the spot. But then Stuart was very much the person sort of behind the scenes and very much in the scenes as well when he was there. So
unbelievable.
It was definitely a double act.
Yeah, we have different roles, probably.
Yes.
No, sure. I'm just thinking back in my home life. My mum did most of the work. My dad wasn't really there. He just wasn't there, period. And it's just the way the dynamics is. And it's like that for a lot of people in the community as well. So, you know, a lot of people can look at you and think, well, okay, you've got a great job. You know, you're educated, both, you know, clever and intelligent in your own right, but you've still got to have that home life, that balance. Where's the glue? How did you manage to stay together? How many years have you been together, if you don't mind asking?
We just had our 25th wedding
anniversary last month, or a couple of months ago, yes.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
But I suppose the glue is that we just love the children, really. And we wanted to be there for them as well. So I think the reason we get on so well is we love talking about them. That's probably
I mean, when we do go out on our own, which is not that often, but when we do, we do end up spending probably the whole evening just talking about the children.
Yes. That's some, I mean, well, you've got seven, so you've got plenty to talk about.
It fills up the whole evening and then, you know, it's time to go home again.
And I guess they've all got their own unique characters as well. So, I mean, starting off with the youngest, what's her name?
The youngest is Mariatu.
Mariatu. So is she not under immense pressure having the other six who are doing so well, or is she equally?
She's
the opposite, actually. She sort of revels in just being sort of passed around from one sibling to another, really. And she just sort of, she's a bit like a sponge, really. She just sort of watches what they do, really,
and
sort of mimics.
And I think she thinks because they've done what they've done, then she should be able to do it very easily.
It's the norm.
Wow. Exactly, yeah.
Wow, incredible. Yeah. And dynamics-wise, is it three daughters you've got? Four boys?
Five daughters. Yeah, so the first one was a girl, then we had two boys, and then girls after that. So it's quite lucky the boys are next to each other in age, and so that worked quite
well. And they're very close, and they still live together. They share a flat in London.
Oh, that's beautiful. So there's no sibling rivalry then?
No, there isn't. They're very close.
Fantastic.
Probably because they play together all the time.
And they all play different instruments as well, I believe.
Well, they all play violin, cello, piano.
Anyway.
They all play at least violin and piano or cello and piano.
Okay.
And then they've each decided which is their favourite instrument out of those.
Wow. So are their favourites individual instruments that they play? So none of them have the same favourite?
No.
Okay.
So the eldest, her favourite is the piano.
Okay.
And then it goes violin and cello. And then it's piano, and then it's violin and cello.
You do talk about them a lot, don't you?
Yeah.
Because to memorise all of that, that's like, wow, okay, yeah, brilliant, I love it. Now, on a real serious note, I mean, they are black in a environment which is predominantly white. Yes, there are a few, but to have collectively your own orchestra in your family, I mean, that is something unbelievable. How do you manage to keep them positive and stay focused when they're in such an environment where their skin colour is different to everybody else's?
I think you have to be very determined and to believe in yourself. And I think we were very careful to make sure that they knew that they could do anything they wanted to do and that they were brilliant and they needed to believe that. I think that's very important.
Yeah, I mean, I had parents who always, you know, I grew up in a time when there were lots of barriers, right, and lots of stereotypes. You know, black people couldn't play football, black people couldn't play cricket, black people couldn't be bankers. And you know, my parents always, you know, showed me role models and people who had broken through those barriers. And so I was taught to believe you could do anything. And so we instilled that in our children. And I believe that every child can do anything they want to if they believe and they have the support. So that's probably the main thing that we've tried to do, is just give them that belief and that enjoyment of what you do, and then let's see what happens.
And I think if you see people breaking down a barrier to anything that's considered to be not your territory, mm-hmm. then I think it's fantastic for anything you do in life. So they looked at top sports people who've done amazing things. We used to look at Muhammad Ali, and it gave them confidence.
Viv Richards.
Yes.
The list goes on and on, doesn't it?
No, that's amazing. I mean, your backgrounds culturally, where are you from? Where's your family from?
So my parents are from Antigua in the West Indies. And
I was born in Sierra Leone. My father's from Sierra Leone, my mother's Welsh.
Wow, okay, that's a bit of a difference. So is that South Wales, North Wales?
South Wales.
Wow, okay. Different. How was that for you growing up in that sort of environment?
Well, I was born in Sierra Leone, and then coming over to Britain in the 1970s was not easy. Okay. And I think I'll never forget it. It was very traumatic. I mean, you remember Britain in the 1970s was not an easy place to be. So.
Yeah, and I probably had a slightly easier time because I was surrounded by quite a large extended family. And in London was probably, what was more... diverse, really, whereas you grew up in a place
which was not diverse.
Not diverse, so you probably had a harder time.
Yeah. A tough time. Yeah. And, you know, me and you was talking, Caddy, about where you knew me from, which was obviously the Black Lives Matter demonstration, which I keep apologising because of the language that I use, but, you know, what did that mean for you on that particular day?
That was such an important day.
Yes, I mean, we all wanted to go. The children really wanted to go. And it was quite interesting how upset they were, you know,
grief-stricken
around that. And, you know, they all grieved in different ways. Some were very vocal, others went very quiet. But they all wanted to go. And I thought that day was really moving, actually. First of all, seeing the sheer number of people who came, seeing the range and ages of people that came, and then seeing people like yourself up there talking and so many emotional stories that I think so many people could relate to. And I think, you know, any black person who, you know, of course we're alive so we haven't been murdered, but I don't think there's a single black person who would not relate to that message on that day.
Yes.
It was very important.
Well,
and it continues to be important.
You know, we've never had anything like that. And I know for me, you know, as being one of the speakers invited by the Next Generation movement, it was almost like very surreal because, as you've just mentioned, the greatest thing about it was the diverse faces. There were so many white faces, young people, which is what kind of drove me into setting up Real Talk TV and being able to have these uncomfortable conversations as well, you know. I think we can't kind of minimise anymore. We have to be able to, for the future of our next generations, be in a position where we can kind of say, look, you know, enough is enough. So it's such a privilege for you guys to have been there and witnessed the whole day, because you could have been tucked away and not have come to that event.
Well, I think one of the most moving things is we don't live far from Forest Recreation Ground. And so we came, I remember coming down the back streets, which were all quite quiet, and I remember thinking, how many people are going to be there? And I remember coming onto the bottom of Mansfield Road and welling up, because I'm starting to well up now, because there were so many people. You just don't know, do you? And then walking onto the field and just seeing thousands. I mean, I've just never seen anything like that, really.
Well, you're making me nervous now, because obviously I had to drive from where I live through Sherwood, and I could see people walking, and I was told initially there was going to be 700 people. So when I did get there, they said to me, well, you know, you're going to be on, this was at 11:15, you're going to be on at 1:15, and you've got half an hour to speak. I was like, really? So, you know, for me, as one of the keynote speakers, to see that crowd grow and actually not know what I'm going to say, because it's almost like being at a wedding. Everybody's kind of said what you want to say. And all I can think in terms of is that, you know, and I've said it before, there was some kind of divine intervention that came into me, as well as others, to be able to create such a powerful day. But what makes it even more stronger, and as you've said, Stuart, previously, is the amount of young people, black, white, you know, Asian, whatever, and that made that day really powerful. Yeah, it does, definitely. You know, just to go back to family dynamics, because this is really interesting. You're at home, you've got, you know, your five, was it four that you had very quickly together?
Yes, four in 4 years, and then five was in 6 years.
Right, so, okay, well, let's take it to the five in 6 years, because five is quite a hefty number. I mean, two's a hefty number for some people. How did you manage that? I mean, because you've got, I'm assuming, was it a daughter or two at that point?
Yeah, so at that point we would have had
two
boys and three girls.
They must have, I mean, okay, I know they've all grown up now, but what was the house like? It must have been really noisy and there was falling out, and was that part of...
There wasn't much falling out.
No, not much falling out. It was very noisy. Yeah. They did lots of creative things, yes. I think. So music was one, but they did lots of sport, lots of games, lots of drawing. I remember them doing lots of drawing, lots of sort of building things, like children do. So they did lots of things that most children do, but I guess they did it together. So for them, there was this sort of little bubble of unit of... Oh.
I think you're missing what I'm trying to say here. They've always been involved in music. Yes. I'm going to give you an example. My sister came home with a recorder, right? Just one person practicing. It drove me insane. So the point I'm trying to make is, yes, they might have been doing all these creative things, but all of them practicing, learning at the same time, how did you manage with that? I mean, now they make a beautiful noise, but I'm sure there was a time where there was just this noise.
Yeah, I don't see it as noise.
That's funny, isn't it? A lot of people say that, but we didn't find it annoying.
I find that, the screeching sound is...
We just love seeing them getting better. And we just didn't hear the noise, really.
And children are interesting, because you're right, there's a period of time when they're just making no progress. Yeah. And they do this in everything they do.
Is that year 9, year 10?
It could be any age, earlier. Yeah, earlier than that, probably year 5 and year 6 or 7. And, you know, months go by and you don't feel they're making any progress. And then one day they come in and they made this big leap. And that's always a joy. Whoa. And then it's almost like something clicks and you don't know when it's going to come, and it'll vary from child to child. And you just have to be patient. But it's quite amusing watching them struggle and try to learn things.
And then we had the extra joy, really, of when they started playing together. Mm. And then that's a whole dynamic which as a parent, you can watch and just think, oh, it's wonderful. Mm. Mm.
Well, as I said to you earlier, I was listening to Ave Maria, and it did it. It made me well up. And it was because I was doing my research and looking in terms of, you know, it wasn't just one individual. It was collectively your family, and that was me as a non-connector, not connected to your family. So I can't imagine. I mean, you must have had moments where you've seen them play, it's all come together, and then you're in floods of tears.
Yes, absolutely.
Is that for you as well, Stuart?
You more than me, but floods of tears. But no, actually, both of us, actually. And
beautiful.
Yeah.
Actually, you do cry.
I do cry.
I'm glad you've admitted that, okay. I'm a big crier, even X Factor gets me.
It's lovely, and you know, I think they seeing children enjoy something and doing something that they love doing, and you know, it's not always easy, right? Because if you're trying to perfect or maybe or improve on a craft, you go through ups and downs. But it's just lovely when they're there on the stage and they're doing something they love, and if it goes well, it's even better.
Well, having one child and being full of pride, let alone seven of them, I mean, they're all over they're all in London now studying, right? So where are they then? Because obviously they're different ages as well, so.
Well, so we've got two who have just graduated, well, sort of graduated. It's been a COVID year, so they haven't actually graduated. So we've got two who have just finished at the Royal Academy of Music. We've got another two who are still at the Royal Academy of Music. We've got one at the Royal College of Music.
And
two at home at school.
That's incredible. And I've got touch on this because it's really important. I know it's something quite dear to your heart as well. The funding or the opportunity within normal schooling to be able to have youngsters develop, how much further on are we to be able to support those who are from, you know, impoverished backgrounds to be able to get to the place where your children?
No, I think we've gone backwards, actually, because I think for a lot of black children and children who are have economic issues, it's very difficult actually to do anything creative, to get funding for anything within state schools. So I think funding for music, for the arts, for drama, for dance, for anything like that is drying up very quickly.
So why is that, do you think, Caddy?
That's a political issue, I think, as much as anything.
Yeah.
As much as an economic issue, because it's a matter of choices. And I think it's opening a gap because you have all the private schools, of course, they put that very front and centre. They put sports, they put arts, they put drama, they put music very much as part of what they're offering. But it's not, it's coming out of state schools. And I think it's going to lead to for even more gap between what you see when you go to a concert hall, which is a problem.
So your family then, it's not luck, it's hard work. I do know that they travel down to London on a Saturday morning. I mean, I saw the clip where they get up at 3:30. And I mean, that's just unbelievable. People looking in would actually say, well, you know what? These are privileged black people. That's why the kids are successful. But I'm sure that's not the case. You know, seven children to raise, raising one enough is very expensive, let alone, you know, I mean, the instruments and stuff, I'm assuming you pay for that. You've had to purchase that over the years.
Yes, it's very
lessons
hard.
And travel and sheet music and strings breaking and instruments being repaired. But, you know, they're not privileged. I think they've you know, we are parents who put a lot into... we've sacrificed things and, you know, it's priorities. For us, giving our children the opportunities for something they do was something that we gave a big priority to. We didn't set out to say, we want you to be musicians. We felt that music was something where they could express themselves and gain confidence from. And then let's see what happens.
They wanted to do it and they were good at it, we felt it was our responsibility then to sacrifice everything to make sure they could.
That's absolutely amazing. And, you know, if there was some advice you wanted to give to parents out there who have got one child, let alone seven, what would you kind of suggest or to them in order to kind of, I suppose, if you like, give them some ingredients where maybe they are struggling a little bit at the moment?
Well, I think the first thing is you've got to love your children. You've got to let them know that you love them. You've got to absolutely believe in them and support them for what they want to do.
Yeah, and encourage them on every step of the way and be there for them. And look, a lot of parents do, you know. I mean, the parents who go and every single Saturday morning watch their child playing football or watch their child doing swimming or ballet or dance class or drama, you know, those, you know, there are lots of parents, and those are the parents, I think, whose children flourish because they feel loved, they feel supported. And children, that's we all like that from our parents in the end, don't we? We want to feel appreciated and loved.
Yes, giving time, giving your time.
So what about the parents who can't because they have to work crazy hours and they're not in that position? Because I'm sure some of our viewers will go, well, you know, I can't, that doesn't work for me. I'm not in that position, you know. What would you suggest?
Well, just having conversations with your children, being interested in what they're doing. And I think if you go out and work for your children, that is showing love. Mm. And that's very important.
Well, I know, Stuart, obviously you've mentioned that you work away abroad at times, and team sounds like a big part of what you are. You know, so I know you've got a book as well, Caddy, that you want to kind of talk about. If you just, yeah, plug it away.
Yeah. Yes, I've just published it, and it basically tells a story of how we brought up the children and what our ethos is and what our ideas are and the struggles that we went through. And I hope it's a book that gives a lot of people hope, because that's what it's about.
And is that now available for people to purchase?
Yes, it's you can buy it anywhere, any bookshop.
Amazon, bookshops, House of Music.
House of Music, okay, Raising the Kenny Masons. Well, I just want to say a big thank you. I knew it was short notice. I mean, I'm thinking about it now, I'm glad, you know, your children weren't here, because I would have really struggled with the names. However, maybe in the future, it's something we can arrange, you know.
And definitely.
It's been a great pleasure having you on the show. And from all our guests, I'd like to say, you know, a warm welcome to everybody, having a beautiful Christmas, should I say, and look forward to seeing everyone in the new year. Thank you.